All right. Okay. Okay, let's start. Father, we thank you for the opportunity that we can come to worship you. Thank you for this Zoom media and the media, even though we are facing this pandemic, even though the door of the church physically are closed, but then your word are not closed. Your word are not bound, because we can still continue to worship you and preach and share. And Father, this is a great opportunity. I want to thank all of them, all of these people, dear people who come in to study the Word of God, even though they already have the worship in the morning. I just pray that this study of Matthew 24 and 25 will really encourage us to really understand the end time. And there's so many false Christs, false prophets. And so we need to really know your Word. Father, help us not to be deceived. Help us to understand your Word, of the Word that you have given us. Help us to study and honor you, not only for our own benefit, but also have an opportunity that how we can also preach, how we can also share. Father, we just commit this time to you. We ask that you will help us. We ask that you will continue to lead us and guide each one of us. And for those who are still trying to Zoom in, pray that they will be able to make it. And I pray that there will be no technical difficulty. Pray that all the equipment and everything will work fine. Commit this hour to you. We ask that you will help us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, you know, Matthew 24 and 25, we are talking about, you know, the end time. You know, Jesus is talking about what will happen. On Matthew 24, verse 3, the disciple is asking, what will this thing be? When will these things be? When will your end time, the end of the world, will come? So he's talking about, you know, that 7 years of great tribulation just before he comes back. I think, you know, Matthew 24, verse 3 is a very important introduction or the context that we must understand in order to really understand, you know, the following passages on 24 and 25. And last time we talked about, you know, within the 7 years of great tribulations. Now, I believe that the church will be raptured before that. And then after the church is raptured, Antichrist will be allowed to rise up. And then he will first of all be king of Europe for the first 3.5 years, and then king of the whole world for the last 3.5 years of that 7 years of great tribulations. Now, during this time, many false Christs, many false prophets will come. And in fact, you know, they were telling the people, hey, Christ is here, or Christ is there. And Jesus is telling them, don't believe them, because, you know, the coming of Christ, you know, is not something that you can just be, you know, be told or here or there. And so, you know, these sessions, we will look at his second coming. Now, just a quick sharing that somehow, you know, I was told, you know, the false prophets, the heresy is just, you know, it's all over the place. I just had a very sad story happen in the Far East that somehow, you know, small church, house church, somehow this person, you know, maybe it's elder from some place, come in and seems to be a nice guy. You know, they most of the house churches are without pastors, so they are in need of a speakers and someone who can really come and share the word of God with them. So, you know, after a while, they thought that this person can really do it, and then so I let him take over the pulpit for once. So as soon as he took over the pulpits, then he beginning to talk about baptism must be in the name of Christ, cannot be in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, which is in blatant, you know, against what Matthew 28, I know the Great Commission is talking about. And then he insists that, you know, it must be, you know, in the name of Christ, otherwise, you know, it would be wrong. And as a result, that he took, you know, half the church, the people just follow him, and half the churches, you know, the churches broke up. And this is very sad. Probably, you know, it will not happen to many of you, because, you know, many of you have been in the church for long enough and know the difference. But sometimes, you know, you hear something like this, somehow the Spirit of God in your heart and tells you something is not right. You know, you cannot completely amen, you know, to the message or something. But then somehow you cannot tell why. You know it is not right. And that's, you know, the Holy Spirit is speaking to us. But what is important, you know, is that so that we know, you know, what is wrong. We know that this is wrong. We know why it is wrong. And we know how to refute it from the scripture. And I hope every Christian, you know, because of this pandemic, will really take a serious look in our Bible studies, you know, in the Word of God. Now, these sessions, you know, we are talking about Jesus' second coming and arrival, coming and arrival. Matthew 24, verses 27 to 31. The main focus will be on the second coming of Jesus. Now, Bible scholar call this his imminent arrival. That means that, you know, he will come. Now, the word imminent, you know, can mean, you know, he will come very quickly. He will come soon. But it can also mean that it will come at any moment, any time, just appear before your eyes. Because Matthew 24, 27, or Matthew is saying, "For just as the lightning comes from the east and flashes even to the west, so shall the coming of the Son of Man be." Now, of course, you know, if you remember, the context is telling you, the false Christ is telling you, Christ is here, Christ is there. So, you know, Jesus Christ is telling them, don't believe them, because, you know, you won't have time to find out, because the coming of the Son of Man is like lightning, just flash, you know, just, you know, he will just appear, you know, and he will just come. And so this is a very important point, you know, to notice. And so I think I mentioned that, you know, some churches, you know, some Korean churches, you know, they study and they discover that, you know, they think they discover that when Christ will come. And so, you know, they prepare and go up to the mountain and wait. Well, you know, that day has passed and Christ has not come, because Jesus has already told us that nobody know the hour of his coming. So don't even try to attempt to find out, you know, and calculate. And I know that some of you may be interested, you know, in the Bible secret codes, you know, here and there, and then try to calculate. No, when the Bible tells us that nobody will know, that we will not know. Okay. Now, this word coming, the coming of the Son of Man, in the English translation, in the Chinese translation, Chinese is 降临, 降临. In the English, you know, you have the word coming, and then you have also, you know, the word come. Now, this is, you know, actually, you know, there are two great words, you know, for this. And one is in, you know, is called, you know, parousia. Maybe you have heard of that. Coming, 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 coming. And this word is found in Matthew 24, verse 3. The sign of your coming. That means that, you know, the disciples is asking, you know, what is the sign of your coming? You know, like a process, like a plane coming down, you know, like, you know, like touching down, but not yet touched down. Verse 24, chapter 24, verse 27, lightning shall, you know, so shall coming of the Son of Man. You know, so this is talking about his coming. Matthew 24, 37, his coming is like the days of Noah. In other words, we'll look into this in more detail. So Jesus is coming. And then also Matthew 24, verse 39, the flood came and took them away, so shall the coming of the Son of Man be. So talking about Jesus coming. This is the word parousia. Now, in the English, you know, if you just look at the English, you probably will not be able to tell, because it's all translated come or coming, okay? There's another word called erakomai, meaning to come, to go, or arrive, or arrival. Now, just think of it, you know, like a plane coming down, you know, it's descending, 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 and then finally touchdown. So this word, you know, erakomai, is found in Matthew 24, verse 30. All tribes shall see the man coming in the clouds. That means that, you know, he's coming in the cloud, and for his final arrival. They see his arrival. And then also, 24, verse 42, be on the alert for what do not know what day the Lord will come, because you do not know the exact date of his arrival, touching down. And so the Son, chapter 24, verse 44, Son of Man is coming at an hour when you do not think he will arrive, you know, touch down, you know, you will think that he will. Now, chapter 25, verse 31, when the Son of Man comes in his glory, he will sit on his glorious throne. Now, this is the second word in arrival. That means that, you know, you talk about, you know, look at Jesus coming, you look at, you know, like as if, you know, the plane is, you know, coming, descending. So as if, you know, he's coming, and then the beginning of before the 7 years tribulations, while Jesus is still in the mid-air, the church will be raptured. And all those who die in Christ will be resurrected first. And then all those, you know, for those of us, if Christ comes now, for those of us who remain on earth, we will be taken to meet Christ in mid-air. And that is 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. So, you know, in mid-air, meaning, you know, Christ is coming. So the church will be raptured and taken to meet him in mid-air. So Christ has not touched down yet. So there were 7 years before the great tribulations. Now, I have also mentioned that after we are raptured, and we will appear before the bema seat of Christ for judgment, not for salvation, because you are saved. Otherwise, you won't be taken. You won't be raptured to meet him in mid-air. It is a judgment for our work for the Lord. You know, some may have done great things, you know, but it is just wood, straw, hay, you know, will be burned and tested, and it will not be remembered. But some may have done precious things, you know, like precious stone, gold, and silver, and it will be remembered. Those are the work that has got eternal value. Now, so, you know, when the church is taken and raptured, so that began the 7 years of great tribulations. So at the end of that 7 years of tribulations, Christ will touch down, he will land. And Zechariah chapter 14 tells us that, you know, he will set foot on Mount Olive. He will come and he will land, you know, in Jerusalem. And so this is not about his coming, his arrival. Now, when he's coming, you know, then that, you know, that also there are many another great, you know, sign that be during the 7 years of great tribulations is that there will be many people dying, many deaths. So the verse 24-28 say, wherever the cop is, the vultures will gather. So that means there would be a lot of death, a lot of dying. So, you know, if you look at Revelations 6-8, this is talking about the first series of judgment, the sixth seal, but this is the fourth seal's own name. And verse 8 of Revelation chapter 6, and I look and behold, an ashen horse, and he who sat on it had the name Death. And Hades was following with him. And authority was given to them over a fourth of the earth to kill with sword, with famine, and with pestilence, and with wild beasts of the earth. So this is the fourth seal judgment. So after the church is raptured, at the beginning of that 7 years of great tribulations, you have the seven seal judgment. 1, 2, 3, 4. The fourth seal, it will kill one quarter of the world populations. That is 25%. That is a lot of people. You know, you compare to the pandemic this time, you know, even though we have a lot of death, but it's nothing compared to, you know, 25% of the world populations. And the word pestilence is definitely mentioned here. And then this pandemic is, you know, it can be viewed as, you know, some of the, like a pestilence, you know, it will spread. In fact, this pandemic is really horrible because, you know, it spread very quickly. It spread, you know, with people without any symptom of sickness, and it will just, you know, it will just spread, you know. And so this is very dangerous. And this is only, one verse. And another verse in Revelation 9:15. And this is the sixth trumpet, okay? And four angels who had prepared for the hour and day and month and year were released so they might kill a third of mankind. A third of mankind. So how many now? So you have the first, the fourth seal kill, you know, one quarter, 25%. So only three quarter of the world population is left. And so, and then now one third will be killed. One third of the three quarter left. So you have a total of how many? 50%. 50% of the whole world populations will be killed by this seven seal, and then the seven trumpets. You know, we are not even into, you know, talking about the seven bowls judgment yet. And then also when Christ comes again, there will be a lot of, you know, there will be judgment too. And we will separate those who believe and those who do not believe. Now, this is the sixth trumpet judgment, and with the seals and the trumpet judgment on one half of the world populations will be wiped out during the 7 years of great tribulations. But not just, you know, this, because you have, you know, it's not even mentioned about the seven bowls judgment. Now, there's 7 years of great tribulations. You have seven seals, seven trumpet, and seven bowl. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. The seventh seal, when open up, is the seven trumpet. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. When the seven trumpet, so you have the seven bowl judgment. So that is a series of judgment. So, you know, there will be a lot of cops, and, you know, a lot of people die, and then the vultures will just gather. And then also, you know, the sign in the sky after the tribulations. Now, you're talking about specifically after the tribulations, meaning 7 years. You know, after the 7 years of tribulations, you will see the sign. But immediately after the tribulations of those days. Now, this is very important. Must pay notice, okay? Not the beginning of tribulations, but 7 years of that great tribulations. Of those days, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will fall from the sky, and the power of the heavens will be shaken. I mean, you have this great, you know, phenomena in the sky. This is at the 7 years, end of the tribulations, is right before Jesus, you know, touchdown coming back. And so if you look at Joel, you know, chapter 2, verse 30, and I will display wonder in the sky and on earth, blood, fire, and columns of smoke. 2:31, Joel, you know, the sun will be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and awesome day of the Lord comes. You know, the Jesus coming back and touching down. So you are talking about, you know, great phenomena, great changing in the sky. And and when Christ comes again. Now, in Acts chapter 2, when the Holy Spirit come upon the apostles and the disciples at that time, the church begins. Peter was talking about and telling them, these people, they were filled with the Holy Spirit. They were not drunk, and they are filled by the Holy Spirit, just as if what he's talking about in Joel. Now, Peter did not say in Acts chapter 2, Joel was fulfilled, because it was not, because, you know, in chapter 2, the Pentecost, the Holy Spirit comes, came down on the apostles and disciples, the church began. And the star, the sky, you know, this phenomena did not happen. So Joel chapter 2 was not fulfilled until the end of these tribulations, after the tribulations, okay? So you have the signs, you know, in the tribulations. And then you have the sign of the Son of Man, chapter 24, verse 30. And then the sign of man, and then the sign of the Son of Man will appear in the sky. And then all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds, of the sky with power and with great glory. Now, and after this, you know, they will, you know, everybody, all the tribes, everybody on earth, Buddhists who are left behind on earth, you know, these people, they will mourn because they will see the Son of Man coming. Now, if you think that this is talking about the rapture of the church, then probably we will have some problem, right? Because, you know, when the church is raptured, you know, we rejoice. You know, we'll be taken up in mid-air to meet Jesus. It will be a joyous occasion. How come we will be mourned? Because it is not talking about the rapture. You know, I believe the rapture has already happened 7 years before the great tribulations. And now at the end of the tribulations, and when Christ comes, touching down, coming down in cloud with great glory, and people and all tribes of the earth will mourn because they will see him coming, because his second coming, his arrival, his touching down is a time of judgment. The first coming of Jesus is salvation. He came, you know, become man, and so that he can die for our sin on the cross. On the third day he arose. And so that was for salvation. His second coming is for judgment. And so, and also the same, you know, similar message is given in Revelation 1:7. Behold, he is coming with the clouds. You know, Jesus is coming with the clouds. And every eye will see him. That is talking about those after the 7 years of great tribulations will still remain on earth. And even those, you know, who pierce him, and all the tribes on the earth of the earth will mourn over him, even so, amen. You know, the people at the end of the 7 years of tribulations, when they see Jesus coming in the cloud, they will mourn because it is a time of judgment. So this is, you know, concerning the sign of man is coming. Now, let me repeat right here. You know, he's not talking about the rapture, because the church is already raptured. Christians already raptured before the beginning of the 7 years of tribulations. Now, this is another proof, you know, that, you know, the church is raptured before the great tribulations, because 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 to 18 tells us that when the church is raptured, you know, we will meet Christ in mid-air. That is a joyous occasion. In fact, all those who believe in Jesus died already will be first of all resurrected. And then, you know, for those of us who remain, we will be raptured, you know, and meet Christ. You know, the word rapture is a very unique word. We'll be raptured to meet Christ, you know, in mid-air, and then we will be together. So it is a joyous occasion. Now, for those of us, you know, have family members like parents, you know, grandpa, grandma, even husband, wife, you know, elderly husband, wife, you know, or maybe even children. And for those of us, you know, who have family members who are Christians, and they may have, you know, they may have died because of some, you know, events, but, you know, we did not lose them, because they will be, you know, in heaven, because they are meeting, you know, in heaven, and we will be reunited with them. And that is a great time together, and that is just a great joy, you know, for Christians. because we believe in Jesus Christ. But after the church is raptured, then you have these 7 years of great tribulations, revelations, you know, from chapter 6, you know, all the way to 19, you know, give us great details of that, you know, events in that 7 years of great tribulations. You have seven seals, you have seven trumpets, and then you have a seven bowls judgment. And between, you know, you have the intercessions. And so there's a very interesting study, you know, for those of you who are interested, might just want to take a look, you know, and study. So you're talking about Jesus' second arrival, touching down, you know, he will be coming in a cloud. In fact, Daniel chapter 7, verses 13, 14, talks about the same thing. The Son of Man will come, you know, in a cloud in glory. And that will be exactly the time, you know, of judgment. So, and then also, you know, when Jesus comes, another thing will happen. Israel will be regathered. Chapter 24, verse 31. And he sent forth his angels with a great trumpet. Now, remember, you have trumpets, but angels with trumpets. And you have trumpets, but God is blowing the trumpets. But make sure you know the difference between the two. And they will gather together his elect. Now, elect here probably talking about the Israelites, the Jewish people, from the four winds, that means from everywhere, and from one end of the sky to the other. So Israelites will be regathered back to the promised land. Why? Because it will be a time of judgment for them, whether they believe in Jesus. And then, you know, if they believe, they will be ushered into the millennium kingdom and enjoy the full benefit of the promise that God has given them, the forefather, Abraham, David, and also the promise in the new covenant, which is a very, very important promise. Now, you know, many are thinking about migrations. You know, you may want to migrate to whatever place. I don't know where you're from. Some of you may be from Hong Kong, some Malaysia. So, you know, you may want to migrate. So where would you go? I understand that the first choice may be United States or Canada, or maybe Australia or New Zealand. I mean, those are some of the top choice. Now, how many of you will seriously consider migrate to Israel? Well, you know, you may want to go to Israel, you know, for a visit to the Holy Land. I know many of you like to go. Many of you have gone and visit, and you will still like to go back again. You know, that's great. But how many of you would like to migrate and go and live there? Because, you know, we may understand that right now in Israel there are all kinds of wars every day, you know, because of the hostile Arab nations surrounding. So you probably will not want to, you know, migrate to Israel. No, I can understand that because we are not Jewish people. But for the Jewish people, since World War II, streams of people, Israelites, have been migrating back, you know, moving back to Israel. And so because they believe that they are the elect, they are the children, they are the people of God, and God has called them back to Israel. And then so at the end of this tribulations, during this 7 years of tribulations time, trumpet will sound, and then the Israelite, you know, they will be regathered. Now, when this regathering began, you know, we don't exactly know. You know, as I noticed, even in history, even after World War II, a lot of Israelites have been, you know, moving back to Israel already. So you have the regather of Israel. So it's a sign of Jesus coming. You know that it is an imminent return. That means that, you know, he will return soon, but he will return anytime. And we also talk about there are two, you know, Greek words, you know, for his coming. One is parousia, coming. You know, the process, his presence. And then also the word erakomai, which is, you know, he touched on his arrival. And now when he comes, you know, there will be a lot of, it will be like nine imminent, you know, coming. So, you know, don't be deceived, you know, by these false prophets, by these false teachers that, you know, telling you, hey, you know, Christ is there. Don't believe that. And I think I like to maybe, you know, really, you know, emphasize on this because, you know, as I have a chance to minister to a lot of churches, Christians in the Far East, what they are saying is there are a lot of heresies. You know, they say, Pastor, you know, we have a lot of heresies important. Now, you know the word heresy. Heresy are not cult. Heresy are not false religions. Heresy are something, you know, that derive and start from Christianity, start from the Bible. And with the Bible, you know, perfect word of God. And then, but when people, you know, interpret it, they add on to something or they delete on something. I mean, that means that they did not, you know, fully, you know, interpret the scriptures according to what the Bible is saying. That's heresy. So when this heresy comes along, you know, people, many Christians can easily be, you know, misled, because, you know, if you come in with a different religion, like Hinduism, Buddhism, you know, or even Islam, you know, they know the difference, because, you know, Islam from Christian, but Islam has a lot of similarity that you two want to be, a lot of, you know, seems, you know, similar passages that you need to be very careful. But even as a heresy, you know, is something come from the scriptures, you know, and add on to something, and then, you know, then you take out, you know, something. If you are not well versed with the scriptures, you know, we can be, you know, easily deceived. So my encouragement to all of us is maybe, you know, take this opportunity to really spend time and dig into the Word of God. Know that, you know, something is right or wrong because, you know, the person is preaching or not preaching from the Word. Know why it is wrong and know how you can refute it. I think that is very important. Many years ago, you know, I have a chance to preach through the book of Revelations in a church in the Far East. And so after, you know, after the first sessions, you know, maybe one of the first, you know, sessions or two, and one of the elder, you know, in that church just come up to me and say, "Pastors, you know, I agree with what you are saying, because, you know, I can amen that." So, you know, he said, before that, there are people come in and talks about, you know, and revelations, and they take different view, you know, and try to find, you know, a fulfillment in the history, you know, of who is riding the white horse, you know, this and that. And he said, you know, well, you know, he seems to be very convincing in his argument. But then again, he said, somehow in my heart, you know, I cannot amen that. He cannot amen that. Now, you know, somehow the Holy Spirit is gracious. He is the elder of the church, and probably he has, you know, read the scriptures, and probably has pastored the church for many, many years. I mean, helped the church in many, many years. Very dear brother, very faithful, very godly brother. I trust, you know, he has also read the scripture. But somehow he said, I knew in my heart something is not quite right, but I cannot tell what is wrong with it. And obviously he can also not refute it. So I hope you'll be able to tell what is wrong, you know, of all the heresies and all the things that is not, you know, right, you know, with scriptures. You will know that it is wrong, and you know why it is wrong, and you know how to refute it. Hey, brother, you know, the Bible did not say that, something like that. Okay, so, you know, and then there'll be many deaths, and then Israel will be regathered. And so you're talking about that 7 years of tribulations, and Jesus is coming back. And then also, you know, another lesson from this passage is verses 32 to 35, is that the lesson of the fig tree, parable of the fig tree. And Jesus is coming back very soon. And now Jesus is talking about, now learn the parable from the fig tree. When its branch has already become tender and put forth his leaf, you know the summer is near. And even so, you too, when you see this thing, recognize that it is near, right at the door. So what Jesus is saying is, hey, during the 7 years of tribulation, just look at the parable of the fig tree. You know, when you see the fig tree, you know, when you see, you know, the branch and the leaves, it is right. So when you see that happen, you know that the summer is near, because, you know, that's when, you know, the fig tree, you know, will have its fruit. And so when you see all this sign, you know, the many deaths, you know, the false Christ, the false prophets, and Israel is regathering, and you see all these things and all these signs, you know Jesus is coming back, meaning, you know, he will touch down very soon. Now, of course, you know, we do not know, nobody will know exactly when, but then, you know, he will come, you know, he's knocking at the door. So, you know, even like today, you know, when you get up in the morning, when you see the sky is dark, you know, with dark cloud, you probably know that it's going to rain, so you may want to bring an umbrella. I remember many years ago, you know, the weather observatory will forecast you have a 50% chance of rain, and at that time, you know, it was not so accurate, so, you know, we know that a 50% chance, and so there's also another 50% chance it will not rain. So I would just open the window and say, well, you know, it's clear. You know, it's bright and sunny, you know, blue sky, so no dark cloud, so okay, no rain. But now, if today's, you know, if they tell you, the weather observer tell you it's going to rain, you better bring an umbrella. It's very accurate now. But then, you know, what Jesus is talking about is when you see that, you know, if from the fig tree, you know that the summer is coming. So when you see all this time, you will know that Jesus is returning, his touching down soon. Because remember Matthew 24 verse 3, the disciple is asking, when will all these things be? When will be the end of the world, you know, shall be? So Jesus is talking about them. Okay, now you say, you know, now you learn from the parables of fig tree. And then it talks about Jesus' arrival with a generation. Now this is a verse that may take some explanation. And truly I say to you, this generation will not pass away until all these things take place. This generation is talking about a particular generations. Now, you know, Jesus is talking about to the disciples, you know, on the Mount of Olive, you know, on Matthew 24 and 25. That was like almost 2,000 years ago. So if we apply to that generation, you know, that generation way past. So definitely he is not talking about that generations, nor is he talking about even the church age, you know, right now. So he's talking about this generation, you know, before that, you know, you'll find that after the tribulations, and then you will also find that in Matthew 24, verse 3, the sign of his arrival, you know, the sign of the end of the world. So he's talking about, you know, his arrival, you know, his final touchdown. So if you count back to that, you know, 7.5 years, talking about that generations. So, you know, if you take a generation to be 40 years, so, you know, it wouldn't take 40 years. That means that the Great Tribulations will not take 40 years. Now, I don't know how you want to define a generations. Some may think longer, some may think shorter, but whatever it is, you know, within, you know, 7 years, if the church, after the church is raptured, within that 7 years, that generation probably will still remain, and they will see Jesus coming back and touching down. So this is something that worth knowing, you know, about the generation. Now, the generation immediately before Jesus' second return, disciples are asking about his return. And then also verse 29, immediately after the tribulations. The tribulation is 7 years. So Jesus is talking about the generation during the 7 years of great tribulations. Now, before that, you know, generation is passed, they will see Christ coming, because, you know, that will be the 7 years. Now, after the church is raptured, after Antichrist will rise and he will sign the treaty, that will mark the beginning of the 7 years of great tribulations. I think I have mentioned before, after the church is raptured, does not begin, the great tribulation does not begin immediately. After the church is raptured, that's probably a time of maybe 30 days from the book of Daniel chapter 12, will allow, you know, Antichrist to rise up. And then first of all, he will sign a treaty with many. And he will first of all become the king of Europe. And so, you know, so there was a small gap of time. And after the, you know, as Antichrist signed the treaty, that will mark the beginning of that 7 years of great tribulations. So you have, 7 years, you know, max. And but also last time we also noticed that, you know, that 7 years, you know, because for the sake of the elect, that 7 years is cut short. That means that it will not be a full 7 years, because if it's a full 7 years, you know, everybody will die, because the judgment is so severe. Seven seals, seven trumpets, and seven bowls judgment are so severe. So, but somehow God is miraculously protecting the Israelites, the elect. So you have Jesus' arrival in a generation. And then you have, you know, a very important reminder, the word of God will be fulfilled, meaning all that Jesus said about, you know, who he is, all that he said about, you know, salvation, and especially here, everything he talks about, you know, the future, about, you know, his second coming, in the prophecy, all everything will be fulfilled. You look at all the prophecy, you know, in the past, in the Old Testament, Christ's first coming, you know, has been prophesied, and it was fulfilled literally, very, you know, accurately. Jesus was born in a manger, you know, in Bethlehem, and all those things, and he died, you know, on the cross for our sin, you know, very carefully, very, you know, very precisely, you know, it was fulfilled. But then you still have some prophecy concerning, you know, his second coming, concerning the millennium kingdom, that has not been fulfilled. And Jesus is talking about that it will be fulfilled. It will be fulfilled. Now, verse 24, verse 35, chapter 24, verse 35, it says, heaven and earth will pass away, but my words shall not pass away. You know, when Christ comes, you know, heaven and earth pass away, but then what Christ has said, his word is eternal. It will not pass away. This is just great. You know, if you look at the things that, you know, we are familiar with today, what are the things that you think are eternal? I mean, if you're an engineer working on iPhone, I mean, you work hard for 2 years or how many years, you know, in doing research and all various part of the iPhone, and then finally iPhone, you know, you know, whatever iPhone 4 comes out, you know, so it was good for a few years, and then iPhone 5, 6, and then 7, and then iPhone 8, you know, when iPhone 8 comes out, before, you know, right after 8 comes out, iPhone 10 comes out. Can you imagine if you were the engineer spending all your life and energy working on that phone? And as soon as it comes out, it becomes obsolete. Because, you know, all these things will pass away. Technology pass away. You look at technology, how it has really come a long, long way. I mean, we probably still have a long, long way to come, you know, and, you know, God has given mankind tremendously, you know, tremendous wisdom to understand, you know, things, you know, invention, you know, and innovations and going to the moon and the rocket science and all those things. It's just beyond my imaginations. But then, you know, all these things will pass away. What has been used in the past, technology fade away because new ones comes along. But the word of God never changes. The word of God will be fulfilled. And Matthew 5:18 talks about the same thing. You know, for truly I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, not the smallest letter or a stroke shall pass away from the law until all is accomplished. The smallest, you know, letters. The Hebrew words, you know, has a yod and a jot and a ditto. It means that it's just a like apostrophe, and it's just a small alphabet. And you know, even that will be fulfilled. It's not talking about, you know, the whole chapters, the whole Bible. It's not talking about the whole sentence. It's not talking about, you know, a word. It's talking about every letter of that word will be fulfilled. So what I am seeing is, you know, Jesus is promising, you know, church with rapture, there will be 7 years of tribulations. Christ has come back, and then he will establish his 1,000-year millennial rule on earth. That's what we call the millennium kingdom. And that kingdom will be the fulfillment of all God's promises to Abraham, to David, and promises to the Israelites. His kingdom, their kingdom will last, you know, in the New Testament. That has not been fulfilled will be fulfilled in the millennium kingdom. This is called the pre-millennial return of Christ. Jesus Christ will return before the millennium to set up the 1,000 years of millennium rule. Now, of course, if you study eschatology, there's another view that called the amillennial view, meaning, you know, there will not be the amillennial millennium kingdom, because the church right now is a millennium kingdom. I really don't see how the church is the kingdom, because, you know, we are not ruling. I mean, you know, we are under government, under, you know, all forms of government, you know, some good, some bad, you know. The church, we are being, you know, supervised, we are being persecuted, you know. So how can the church cannot be the kingdom? Because then the church is raptured, the kingdom, whatever God has promised to Israel will be fulfilled. Okay, and then Mark, you know, verses 13, verses 30 to 31. Truly I say to you, this generation will not pass away until all these things takes place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my word not pass away. Meaning the word of God is trustworthy. Okay, you know, this is very important, a very great reminder. And then Luke 16:17, it is easier for heaven and earth to pass away than for one stroke of a letter of the law, you know, or to fail. Now, as for Luke chapter 16, you know, it's very interesting to go back to the context. It's talking about divorce. Jesus talking about divorce, and then before that, and then after that. But all of a sudden, in the middle, you know, he inserts this verse. The word, you know, will be fulfilled. Why? What has got to do with that? It's very interesting study. Go back and look at the context, okay? And 2 Peter 3:10, by the day, you know, but the day of the Lord will come like a thief, in which the heavens will pass away with roar, and elements will be destroyed in intense heat, and the earth and its works will be burned out. You know, that's the end of the 7 years of tribulations. Everything, you know, happened. And so, you know, of course, there's a scholar debate whether this talks about, you know, the end of the 7 years of great tribulations or the end of the millennium. And so, but anyway, you know, this old heaven and earth will pass away. But the important point is, you know, Jesus' word will not pass away. And then, you know, when Jesus comes, you know, the third important factor here is the point is that the day of judgment, the timing of his arrival, but the day, you know, an hour, no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, nor the Son, but the Father knows. So, you know, this is, you know, repeated again and again, that, you know, only God the Father knows of Jesus' arrival. But you know, as Jesus come, you know, parousia coming, you know, church is rapture, 7 years of great tribulations, touchdown, and it will be a time of judgment. Now, first of all, before the judgment, talks about the day of Noah. The days of Noah for the beginning of the Son of Man, for the coming of the Son of Man, will be just like the days of Noah. He's making a comparison. Now, for as those days, you know, which were before the flood, they were eating and drinking, they were marrying and giving in marriage until the day of Noah entered the ark. And they did not understand until the flood, you know, came and took them away. So shall the coming of the Son of Man. So, you know, the day of Noah, you know, they have actually plenty of a warning, because in those days, the people knew the flood is coming because they see Noah building the ark. And Noah took a long time to build the ark. And then they just don't believe it. You know, they keep on doing what they are doing, eating, marrying, you know, and things like that. And then the flood just came, just all of a sudden. They knew it is coming. They did not know when. They have been warned, but they do not believe it. Now, when the flood came, this is very important. When the flood came, only Noah and his family of eight were left behind. And the rest of all the people, you know, were just washed away, taken away. And so shall the coming of the Son of Man, it will be a time of judgment. So Jesus' second coming will be a time of judgment. Many will be taken away for judgment. Some will be left behind. So with this, you know, with this context, now you come to this verse, you know, one is taken, one is left behind. Then there shall be two men in the field. One will be taken and one will be left. Two women will be grinding in the mill. One will be taken and one will be left. So the question is, are you the one taken or are you the one left behind? So if you just take this verse out of context and ask most Christians, you know, one is taken, one is left behind, which one are you? Probably many will say they are the one taken, right? You know, I don't know how you respond to this. You know, this is a virtual online teaching. You know, in the real sessions, I will see many people raising their hand because, you know, they think they are taken. Why? Because they read, you know, into this verse, the rapture. Now, if this is the rapture, then you want to be the one taken. But the word for rapture is not this word. It's a different word. We will go into that later. So 7 years of great tribulations, you want to ask, when this happened, is it at the beginning of the 7 years of tribulations? No, it's talking about at the end of the 7 years of great tribulations. The church is already raptured, you know, taken to meet Christ, raptured to meet Christ and meet air. So the church is not, you know, on earth already. So which one are you? You are the church. So you are not even on earth right now. I mean, after the 7 years of great tribulation, because you were taken. So at the moment the church is raptured, everybody that was left behind will probably, they were not Christian. They were not, they don't believe in Jesus. But at the end, you know, throughout that, in other church, once the church is raptured, many will believe. Many Greek, many Israelites, many Jewish people, many Gentiles will believe. So at the end of the 7 years of great tribulations, when Christ comes back, he's talking about, you know, Christ come with just like the day of Noah. The flood came, they washed away, only Noah and the family of eight left behind. So at the end of the tribulations, the one that is taken is the one taken out for judgment. The one that is left behind are those who believe in Jesus, who believe in God, and they will be ushered into the millennium kingdom. The proof, you look at the immediate context, Noah, you know, when the flood came, you know, everybody in the world were washed away, taken away. Only Noah's were left. If you look back into Matthew 24, verse 3, he's talking about that end, you know, the end of the world and then his final, Jesus coming at the end of the world. So this verse is now is worth something to be noticed. I think I've taken quite a bit of time to trace through the context so that you will realize that, you know, when the one talking about one is taken and one is left behind, you are not the taken one nor the left behind one, because, you know, you are already taken up, you know, to meet Christ in mid-air. You are raptured unless you have not believed in Jesus. If you have not believed in Jesus, if the rapture happened right now, those surrounding you will be raptured and see Christ and they'll meet Christ in mid-air, and you'll be left behind. So maybe, you know, you will believe right away or whatever, because, you know, so, but, you know, as soon as you believe in the 7 years of great tribulations begin, you will face great tribulations, because the Antichrist, the devil, the Satan, and the false prophets, you know, will go out to persecute. And So if at the end of the 7 years, if you didn't die, you know, you've left behind, and so you are the blessed one. So because you know you believe in Jesus, you believe in God, so you'll be going into the millennium kingdom. So this is, you know, when Christ comes, it will be the day of judgment. So some spiritual lessons: Jesus' second coming is imminent. It will happen. It will happen anytime. Maybe tonight. Maybe, you know, tomorrow. We don't know. It can be happen very soon, and it can be maybe another, you know, 50 years, 100 years. We don't know. But the word imminent means it can appear anytime. No one knows when will Jesus come again the second time. You know, only God the Father knows. Christians should not be afraid, because the church will be raptured before 7 years of great tribulations. You know, I promise, you know, we will go into one sessions on the proof of the great of a tribulation rapture of the church. And then you have Christians should be prepared to meet the Lord before the judgment seat of Christ, you know, for rewards. So that means that whatever you do, you know, you will be raptured, and you will appear before the bema seat of Christ. That judgment is not judgment for salvation, because you know, because you have belief and you will be raptured, but we will appear before the Lord and give an account of our work. So that is something that we need to, you know, to really ask God, am I serving the Lord? I know many of you are serving the Lord, but you know, I have an experience. So I serve the Lord, you know, but then I sometimes just realize there are things that I do, so busy, you know, with a lot of administration work, a lot of things that probably, you know, I'm not quite sure they have, you know, eternal value. You know, sometimes, you know, I just don't know. Sometimes, you know, I'm a pastor for many years. I was a pastor, senior pastor for many years in many, I mean, a few churches. And we do have deacon's ward meeting. And sometimes so meeting can last for hours and hours and hours. And when you look back and say, wow, you know, do we really need that much time? There was this deacon from another big, you know, denomination tells me that, you know, their deacon board meeting is Sunday after church from 12, and then they meet until 12, maybe 1 p.m. or they meet until, you know, almost midnight. Oh boy, you know, I think those meetings are just tired us out. Okay, I don't know. If there's a better way to do this. Maybe, you know, we pray more. You know, do we spend hours to pray and then come before the meeting, or just do we just, you know, just a celebrating prayer and then just talk and talk and talk? And sometimes, no wonder, you know, we have so much arguments. And so Christians are saved by grace through faith, not by works. Now this we know. 7 years of great tribulations will be a time of great judgment when he will die. God's work, his promises will be fulfilled. Israel will be regathered. Believing Jews will enter the millennium kingdom. God's promises will be fulfilled. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for your great love for us. We thank you for all that you have done for us. Thank you for your faithful promises. We see great troubling signs in today's world. The government, persecutions, pandemic, pestilence, war, and a famine. Many people will die. Many people lost a job. Yeah, many people are facing very bad economy situation even right now. Father, I just pray that you will help us and give us the faith to really trust you. I just pray that all of us who are facing this difficulty will have the wisdom, the courage, the strength to trust you. Help us to, you know, open up your word, because your word will be fulfilled. Your word will give us encouragement that we will come to know you even more. Help us to know your word. Thank you for this time. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Okay, you know, we probably will, I'll stop sharing.
Amen.
I'll stop sharing, and now we probably, you know, you want to go to, yeah. So any questions, you know, any suggestions, any feedback?
Pastor, I'd like to ask, this COVID-19 and then things are around pandemic are happening right now, like we just passed, like, while locust, you know, they're eating up all the plants, you know, and you know, like hailstorm, fire in Australia, all this, is it some kind of sign? Is it anything related to Revelation? That's question one, yeah? Question two.
Okay, wait, let me answer first. You know, you give me too many questions, remember. Okay, sure. These are the signs that tells you the 7 years of great tribulations are coming. Do not be mistaken. We are not in the 7 years of great tribulations. Now, I know that there are famine, there are pestilence, there are war, and then countries are fighting against each other, like North and South Korea, you know, and things like that. Now, these are the signs that tells you Jesus is coming, you know, very soon. The church will be raptured. It'll be a sign of the 7 years of great tribulations. These will be the things that were happening, but much more severe. But we are not in that 7 years of great tribulation. Yes. Okay. All right. Your second question.
Second, thank you. Second question would be that I understand the Jewish belief that the Feast of the Trumpet is something aligned with the second coming of the Lord.
So what is your question?
I mean, that is like every Feast of the Trumpet shows that will be the coming of God. I'm not sure.
You know, the Feast of the Trumpet just for, you know, foreshadow, you know, foretell, you know, the Millennium Kingdom. If you study that, you know, it's very interesting to study the festival of the Israelites from the Passover all the way, you know, it's just like, you know, breaking down the church age. It's very interesting, you know, the church is not mentioned in the Old Testament. For the Jewish people, they believe, you know, fervently that the Messiah is coming again. What happened in the first time when Christ come, they missed it. You know, they didn't believe that the Christ was born in the manger, become a man, so that he can die on the cross for our sin. They did not believe that Jesus is the Messiah. But don't be mistaken. They believe fervently that the Messiah will be coming. And so, you know, so they see, you know, as far as the Jewish people is concerned, they have, you know, they see the world has got two ages, you know, this present age and the future age of the millennium when Christ come. So they do believe in Jesus coming, the Messiah coming, and then they do believe that, you know, they will have the millennium, I mean the kingdom, because, you know, when Christ rise, you know, to heaven in Acts chapter 1, verses 5 or 6 or 6 or 7, the disciples were asking Jesus, is it this time that you will restore the kingdom of Israel? And Jesus' reply is, nobody know what time will be. Only Father will know. But now, you'll be filled by the Holy Spirit, and you'll be God witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and then to the end of the world. So Jesus talking about the church, you know, I mean, the kingdom is being set aside temporarily because the Jewish people at that time do not believe in Jesus. But they do believe, you know, that the Messiah is coming back. Okay, any other questions? Do you find that interesting? You know, the two person, one is taken, one is left behind. Do you find that interesting? You know, I find that, you know, whenever I ask, you know, many Christians, they probably will think they are taken away. And there's one example I want to repeat. Is that, you know, many times, you know, we kind of read, you know, into the scriptures. We do not let the scriptures, you know, expound itself. So, you know, we believe in the rapture of the church, and we think this is the rapture of the church. So I see some new Chinese translations, and the way they translate the word Jesus, you know, that one is taken, paranambano, you know, when they translate that word, you know, as if that is talking about, you know, the rapture, which, you know, in Matthew 24 and 40, that is not talking about the rapture of the church. And in fact, you know, the word rapture is a totally different Greek word. Yeah. And we will have more interesting study to come, because then later on you will have, you know, the 10 virgins, you know, are you the wise one or are you the foolish one? Because the wise one has a lamb and has got oil. The foolish one doesn't have. And then also you have the talents, you know, five talents. The Chinese translate, you know, 五千, 二千, 一千, you know, 5,000, 2,000, 1,000. So are you the 5,000? Are you the 2,000? Are you the 1,000? That is probably a difficult passage to explain. So I hope you will stay on with us and go to the study. Very interesting study.
Right.
All right. Any other questions?
There is one question I would like to ask.
Sure.
There is this other group of people that do not believe in the church being raptured, the pre-tribulation period. And then there's this, I don't want to go into the theory of it, it's not really so important. But there is this one group that talks about, I'm not sure whether it's correct, it's about the dispensationalism theory, is it? That they believe that they are the Christians are still left behind.
You got to be kidding. You got it all wrong. This. Dispensation means that the church will be raptured because you talk about the Old Testament and the New Testament. So the, those are the dispensation. The church will be raptured before the 7 years of Great Tribulation.
Oh.
At the end of it, you know.
So that's correct. It, you
know, dispensation is a correct
theory. That's correct theory. Okay.
Let me repeat.
So that means
it's a correct theory, meaning that, you know, the church will be raptured before the 7 years of Great Tribulations, and then there will be 7 years of Great Tribulations, and then Christ will come back. It's called the pre-tribulation rapture of the church. And then also, you know, the dispensation also talks about pre-millennial kingdom. Christ will come back pre-millennial, before the millennium kingdom. So, you know, if you have time, you can go into more details into all this different theory. What you will encounter is probably, you know, people are talking about the amillennial will, meaning there will be no millennium kingdom. And right now, you know, the church is a millennial. And if that's the will, then they probably will believe the church will be, you know, taken and will be raptured at the end of the tribulations. So I will explain to you at the end of the series why I believe in the pre-tribulation rapture theory because of the kingdom, because of the belief of the millennium kingdom.
Thank you so much. That will help a lot.
Okay, sure. You know, but stay with us because, you know, this series is just hopefully just a beginning. And so hopefully that will really encourage us, you know, encourage all of us to study the word, you know, more in depth.
Right.
So any other questions?
Stephen, there are some questions in the chat. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, there's one question by SK Liao. SK Liu. Is it Liao?
You don't have to mention the name, you know. Mention the name. Just mention the questions because the person checked, so he may want to. Yeah. So what's the question?
Sure. It says some say this generation refers to the generation that sees the reborn of the nation of Israel. Can you comment on this?
Well, the reborn of Christ, you know, of Israel is really the millennium kingdom. So when you're talking about that, you know, if go along with what we studied, so you're talking about the 7 years of Great Tribulations. You're not talking about our generation. You know, our generation right now, you know, it's not talking about these generations. Now, you know, if the church happened, you know, rapture happened tomorrow, then you have a 7 years of Great Tribulations, then this generation will probably, you know, apply to us. But, you know, that's what not Jesus is talking about. He's talking about that, you know, Christ return and then the 7 years, that generation. But since you do not know when the church will be raptured, you know, I don't know what you are thinking now. I mean, my praying, you know, it would be nice if the church is raptured right now, right? It would be just great, wouldn't it? Won't you like that happen, you know, if the church is raptured? And so, but now, you know, we don't know, we don't have what happened. One time there was this sister answering and say, you know, she really loved the church to be raptured. But then, you know, and then she also said, maybe not yet because her parents have not received Christ. I think that is a very good reminder. You see all these things, you know, the more urgency to preach the gospel, that many people will come to know Christ. So they don't have to go through that 7 years of Great Tribulations. Okay, any other questions on the chat side? We have a few more minutes.
There's one question here. You mentioned that it's it's half of the people in the world that would be destroyed, but according to this person, it's one third. Would you care to explain a bit more?
Well, you know, I already mentioned the fourth seal killed one quarter. So we have, you know, you have three quarters left behind. The sixth trumpet kill one third out of that remaining three quarter. So that makes half. You mentioned twice. You know, the first time, you know, fourth seal killed one quarter. So we have three quarters left. So the sixth trumpet kill one third of the remaining three quarters. So you have half the populations. And that is not even mentioned in the seven bowls and when Christ comes back. You know, that means that a lot of people will die because they do not believe in Jesus.
Pastor, I've got one question. There's a group of people, I mean, almost about 1 billion of them, believe that there's going to be the coming of the Messiah, they call Mahdi, I think. And to them, is this Messiah is going to come. But to us, I think this Messiah is going to come to judge the world. What are your opinions on this?
Well, it depends. You know, he may call the same name Messiah, but you know, who do they refer to this Messiah to be? I mean, if they think this is Jesus Christ, you know, that Christ comes again will be for judgment. So the question is, do they believe in Jesus? Now, this is something I learned from the from my sister, you know, who is doing, you know, who has done evangelism among the Muslim. And they find that, you know, the Muslim people have a lot of terminology that is similar to what we believe, like, you know, the triumph God, the Trinity. They also have the Trinity, but their Trinity is not our Trinity. Our Jesus is God, you know, the second person of the Godhead. But to them, you know, Jesus is only a prophet. So, you know, you may have the same name, but you need to ask them, please define what do you mean by this Messiah? Who do you believe that to be? And so, you know, if it is not Jesus, though, I mean, all religions, you know, they have, I mean, other religions, they have their own, you know, they have their own savior, they call different names. So we need to be very careful. And this is what I like to repeat is that, so, you know your word of God so that you know what is wrong, you know why it is wrong, and you know how to refute them from scriptures. You know, I wish no Christians would be able to say, hey, this is wrong because this verse talks about it differently, and not just, you know, and not just argue based on your gut feeling or based on, you know, somebody told you, you know, in the past.
There are a couple, you know, of other questions.
We started this Bible study so that we can go into the questions and then do homework and then come for discussions. And I find that, you know, this is very helpful to many Christians because they have a chance to go back to the Bible and dig into it, you know, before they just come in and just share, you know, what their feelings are. Okay, next questions. Maybe we have time for one or two more.
What is your view about churches practicing shofar blowing? I think this question is relevant, but it'd be good if you can comment on that because you mentioned about the trumpet.
Well, you know, why do they practice? I mean, if it's a joy, a celebration, you know, they it's a preference, you know, go ahead. Just like some church worship with piano and trumpet and the whole orchestra, some church, you know, say no musical instrument. I mean, so what is the purpose? But if they're saying, no, you have to do that in order to be safe, then it's wrong. I mean, you know, the shofar, you know, maybe a horn, right? You know, they blow, you know, maybe just, you know, one of the musical instrument, one of the part of the worship, just like some church has choir, some church don't have choir. So, you know, it just depends on how you want to look at it and how you see that as part of the worship. But, you know, never make that as something that I do and therefore I'm holier than thou and that kind of attitude.
Okay, several questions have come in, but I think just a quick one. Is it heresy to say that all Christians will go to heaven?
Of course. I mean, wait a minute. Let me define. All Christians will go to heaven, qualified by saying true Christian, truly born again Christian. You know, a lot of people call themselves Christians, but they are not Christians. So, you know, that's not how you define that. But if you say that all people will go to heaven, that is a heresy. I mean, if you don't believe in Jesus, you just won't go to heaven. You need to believe in Jesus as a savior and asking him to forgive your sin. Trusting him as your savior, then you go to heaven. Now, some people may be born in a church, you know, I mean, in a Christian church because the parents are Christians and they grow up, you know, thinking that they are Christians, but they have not truly believed in Jesus, then they are, you know, then they are not saved. Will baby be raptured? I believe that baby will be safe. You know, depends on, you know, when will happen. If it raptured the baby, sure, you know. You know, that is not too many verses that talks about, you know, if a baby safe. The only verse you can count on is David, you know, when his son died because of the adultery with Bathsheba. You know, when the son died, you know, he rose and then, you know, his servant is, I mean, his people were just surprised. Now, why he arose? He said, well, I can only go to him and he cannot come back to me. Give me an indication that, you know, the baby is with God. So that is probably the only verse that we have talking about baby salvation. So if that baby, you know, before they come to know right and wrong, you know, I believe that they will be saved by God's mercy because, you know, there's no way they believe in Jesus because they can't tell, you know, from that yet. So maybe we'll take one more questions because of time.
So Dr. Tang, I haven't got any questions.
Yes.
But I just wanted to say something that was quite amazing. My name is Sarah and I'm from South Africa.
Oh, great. So welcome.
It's quite a privilege today and to just listen to what you have got to say. Our congregation is very involved in Israel. So with the shofar blowing, we celebrate all the feasts with Israel. And I would quite like to move there. I know you were saying.
Well, you know, I know some people really work, you know, move there. So, you know, God bless you as you lead. You know, it is a great joy to, you know, to really, you know, reach out to the Israelites people because it is, you know, it is on God's heart. But, you know, Israel, the Jewish people, they are one of the hardest people, hardened heart, you know, to ask them to believe in Jesus. You know, it is not easy. But somehow God will do the miracle. Okay, I think it's about time. Shall we just close? Dr. King Tai, are you still there? If you are, can you lead us in a closing prayer?
Yes, sir.
Okay, please.
Let us pray. Thank you, Father, for your word. All we see today will pass away one day. Heaven and earth will go away, but only your word will remain. Even though we may be suffering today on earth, having troubles and pandemic, these are all temporary. But your word is eternal. So we can trust in you and we can learn your word and fill our hearts with your word. And let your spirit fill our lives as well, that we may walk in the Christ-likeness to glorify your name all the time. So
amen.
May you bring us forward. And that you use Dr. Tang mightily to bless many people with your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Okay, just a brief announcement. If you are Cantonese, if you understand Cantonese, I have a Cantonese worship at 4 p.m. my time, Los Angeles time, you know, 4 p.m. tomorrow. And so if you go to my website, BibleExperience.org, you will find the Zoom ID and everything. And then also I have a class on Zechariah on a Monday, my time, every time. San Jose time at 5:45, and you go to my website, you know, that is if you understand Cantonese, you'll be able to find the Zoom ID also. And then also two more courses are coming, you know, it's on major covenant, Abrahamic covenant, Davidic covenant, and New Covenant, how the whole Bible will be linked together. That will probably begin in the early part of June. And then my son Paul will help me, you know, lead the Bible study in Genesis in English, and that will also come in the early part of June. So go to my website and notice. I will try to get your email, okay? Thank you so much for joining the worship, and God bless.
Thank you.
All right. And then we will see you same time next week.
Thank you
very much. So I shall end it now. God bless. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Bye bye. Bye bye.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye bye. All right, end meeting now. Bye bye.